Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Earlier this week, or it might have been the end of last week, I got a drop-down window in my computer that said that somebody was trying to hack me, somebody was trying to take control of the computer, and that there's a possibility of identity theft. So I immediately called the person who installed the computers for us when I was in the law practice. He's been our IT guy for years and years, and he hopped onto the computer, which you can do long distance, and solved the problem in about 2 or 3 hours. But identity theft, I got to thinking about it, is one of the major problems that we face in our society. It's become a crime that has, at least according to the statistics of the Bureau of Justice, that has at least 17.6 million people who are victims of identity theft in the year 2014. Translated into more manageable numbers, that's 33 persons every minute in the United States. It's 33 persons whose identity has been stolen or otherwise affected. So you can see that it's a big problem. But when I started to think about it, I decided that there was even a bigger problem. The bigger problem that we have is to allow other people to define who we are. Let me repeat that. Identity theft is to take our identity away, but the bigger problem that I think we confront is to allow other people to define who we are. I was reading a short biographical sketch on Elizabeth Barrett, who was a wonderful poet. Even at the age of 6, she published her first book of poetry. By the age of 12, she published 4 or 5 books of poetry. And she won numerous awards in Victoria, England, and was recognized by many people. So they were surprised when it was found out that she was actually, according to many people, an invalid, and she was also a recluse. What I mean by that is that her parents, she had a fall and her spine was affected. And the doctors told her that she was an invalid and would never be able to walk again, and she was in bed for years and years. And her parents decided that she wasn't going to be allowed to be seen by anyone, and so they basically shut her up in her home, and she became a recluse. They defined who she was. And it wasn't until a young poet who loved her poetry came and rescued her, a man by the name of Robert Browning. So you probably know Elizabeth Barrett Browning, a poet of the 1800s who had a tremendous impact. But her parents defined who she was, and until the parents stopped doing that, or until she decided she no longer needed that, no longer wanted that, she was a person whose life was limited by their definition. It's important for us to recognize that there are many forces out here, not only in families, not only in parents, not only in children, but many forces in our society which want to define who we are. In fact, the whole advertising gamut that we have to put up with on radio and on TV and on YouTube and various other media, the whole process is a process of getting you to define yourself in the terms that they provide rather than in terms that are provided by anyone else. And so let's take a look at this a little bit more closely. How can we prevent people from defining us, defining who we are, rather than some other source, and that source should be Scripture. The first thing that we must recognize as always, we always have to come back to it, not because that's the way I want to approach a subject. We always have to come back to this because that's what the Bible does. The Bible always tells us to start with who God is. And so we find in this gospel lesson for today that the disciples are walking towards Jerusalem and Jesus turns to them and says, who do people say that I am? And they say, well, some say John the Baptist, and others say Elijah, and some people say I'm one of the prophets. And he says, but I want to know, who do you say that I am? You see, that's the first question of identity that we have to ask. We have to first of all ask the question, who do we we believe God is who Jesus Christ is. And until we have made that definition clear in our minds, everything else is up for grabs and up for sale. Every bit of our identity can be bought by someone unless we know that we are solidly grounded in who Jesus is. And so that's the question that you and I have to answer. And we have to answer that question again and again and again. Because you see, it is so easy to start the wrong way around. The way we're supposed to start is with who God is. And then from God we get our values, and from our values we get our lifestyle. But we have a tendency as people to do it the opposite way around. We start with the lifestyle that we want. We start with the idea that is given to us by advertising or by our parents or by our neighbors. This is the kind of lifestyle that you ought to be leading. And if you do X, Y, and Z, you can also have A, B, and C. And so we go on and on and listen to people. Because we turn things around. We start with our lifestyle, and then we say, what kind of God can we get who will fit our lifestyle? And so rather than asking the question, what kind of lifestyle should we have because of the God that we worship, we start the other way around, and we start buying gods from us. Gods who do not take so seriously the fact that we are to worship Him on the seventh day. God does not take seriously the fact that you and I might want to drink too much at different times. God who wins his eye and shuts one eye when he finds out that we have been watching and looking at pornography. So we define the God on the basis of the lifestyle we want, when Scripture tells us that if you want to get your identity straight, you have to start with who God is to answer the question. Who do you say Jesus is? So that's the first point that we must make if we're going to prevent both identity theft and having other people define who we are. The second one is that we need to let God define us. We need to let God name us. We need to find out, as God did with Abraham, Abraham needed to have a new name. Because he was what? He could call it by God to do a certain thing, which was to lead the family, the Jewish family, and then spread out the message to the entire world. So the second point is that we must allow God to name us. Remember, even earlier in the first chapter of John, we find that Jesus turns to Peter and he says, Simon, you're no longer going to be Simon, you're going to be Peter the Rock, which is Greek for rock. We find that you and I can find that Christ is willing to name us. In fact, as we did with the young people a few moments ago, God has already decided who we are. And that is made known to us in baptism. We find out in the first chapter of John chapter 1, verse 12, we find out that what? We are the children of God. We are the children. Somebody says, who are you? Can you imagine? But if you were to answer, I'm a child of God, probably people would think that we're a little crazy. But maybe that kid could have been. We'd be crazy for our Lord and be willing to identify as children of God. Or as Jesus says on another occasion, that we are what? No longer servants, but we are His friends. We are a friend of God. Next time you get a teleprompter, get a telephone call asking you to do something, they say, who am I talking to? Tell them that you are a child of God. They'll hang up right away. You are a child of God, and that you are a friend of God. And then ask, if they haven't hung up yet, ask them if they would like to become a friend or a child themselves. So first of all, we have to answer the question, who do we say that God is? And second of all, we have to accept the name that God gives us. But third of all, we must not only go through the first two steps, we must also act on this. In other words, we can't just confess our faith with words, but we must act on it. There's one way of remembering this that I remember this, is this particular chapter 8 in Mark is the center of the gospel according to Mark. It's right smack dab in the center. So if you want to know what the center of the gospel is, according to Mark, you have to read chapter Mark, the incident or the events that occurred around Caesarea Philippi. But there's more to just being the center in a book. There's something else, and that is to be the center in our lives. There's a, how many of you like Yogi Berra? Just a few hands ago. He was the catcher for the New York Yankees and was also a coach and manager, and he was known for his witticisms and his wisdom. And one of the, let me give you two examples before I give you the one that I want to speak about, just to give you a flavor of it. One of his favorite sayings was, if you don't go to their funerals, they won't come to yours. Think about that for a minute. Another one was, that restaurant is so busy, nobody goes there anymore. Some of them think, you know, there's something truth to that, but we can't quite figure out the twist. And the one that I want to use today is the one where he says, if you come to the road, come to a fork in the road, take it. Again, you know, but you know what? That is not so impossible to apply to us. Because so many of us would like to have it both ways. We would like to go our own way, do our own thing, and yet have Jesus allow us to follow him. But Jesus is saying you can't. You cannot just go your own way and still follow him. If you're going to follow him, you're going to have to give up your own way and take up the cross. So, first of all, who is Jesus? Second of all, let him name us. Identify us as his children. Third of all, we must follow him. There's a famous sculpture by the name of Augustus Rodin, who was a French sculptor. The story is told about him where he was going along a highway or a road and came across this incredible, beautifully huge carved crucifix. And he immediately wanted to have it, and he bought it for himself, and he brought it home, and he discovered that his home was too small for the crucifix. That he had to knock out some walls and knock out the roof in order to accommodate the crucifix and scene. And that's exactly what he did. That's exactly what you and I need to do in our lives. We need to knock down a few walls that we've been hiding behind. We need to knock down some roofs that have been keeping us down, and we need to recognize that we must build our lives around the cross of Christ.